Well, thank you for tuning into this sermon on the Antichrist or the man of lawlessness. We're going to be looking at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 6. Now, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together with him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed either by a spirit or a spoken word, or a letter seeming to be from us to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know what is restraining him now so that he may be revealed in his time. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we praise you for your rule over all the earth, for the joy of Christ, the coming of Christ, the good news. Spirit of God, we pray that you'd outpour, that you'd work in this sermon to your glory, that those that would hear it would respond with faith and obedience. In Jesus' good name, amen. Over the next 2 weeks or so, we are going to be looking at the man of lawlessness, or the person of who is attributed to the Antichrist, the man of lawlessness. And we need to be careful as we enter this chapter of 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2. There's much that we cannot know about this man of lawlessness, and many have speculated and said things and have ended up looking very foolish when their predictions did not come true. The Gospel Coalition wrote an article on this topic called The Seven Most Popular Contenders for the Title of Antichrist, and most of these people are, actually all these people basically are dead. Number one, the Pope. The all-time most popular contender for the title of the Antichrist is the office of the Catholic Papacy. Roman Catholic popes, Martin Luther, John Calvin, Cotton Mather, William Tyndale, and a long list of other Protestants have called the Pope the Antichrist. Two, Nikolai Jedi Carpathia. Carpathia is the fictional antagonist in the Left Behind series books written by Tim LaHaye and Jerry B. Jenkins. While no one thinks Carpathia is the actual Antichrist, he's the architect for what many believe the Antichrist will look like. 3. Nero Caesar. Many biblical scholars think that the Mark of the Beast in Revelation 13 verse 18, 666, equates Nero Caesar. 4. Hitler, for obvious reasons. 5. Henry Kissinger or Mikhail Gorbachev. This is mainly in the 70s and 80s. These men were entitled the Antichrist by several Americans. 6. Napoleon. Tsar Alexander of Russia called Napoleon the Antichrist, an enemy of God, because he liberated the Jews. And then the tie is American presidents. Virtually almost all the American presidents since George Washington have been suspected of being the Antichrist. None of these people were the man of lawlessness or Antichrist figure, though. And I want to encourage you, instead of trying to figure out the identity of the man of lawlessness, and often our interpretation of the man of lawlessness is connected towards our dislike for someone, we ought to interpret this section and accurately apply this section to our hearts and lives. We need to be reminded again why this book of 2 Thessalonians was written. There's 3 chapters, and each chapter has a reason. Reason number one, chapter number one, was to encourage these Thessalonians because they were undergoing persecution. And how important is encouragement now, in that when we're beaten down and by difficult situations? Very important. Paul encourages them. 2, in chapter 2, Paul wrote this letter to deal with the false doctrine, the false teaching that the second coming of Jesus had already happened, of which we think that they were attributing that idea and that teaching to the Apostle Paul, which he addresses. In chapter 3, there was this false idea with some people that the coming of Jesus was very soon, and because it was going to be very soon in their lifetime, they didn't have to work. And Paul writes this letter to deal with the issue of ongoing laziness. So with these issues in mind, we can now tackle this section on the second coming of Jesus and the man of lawlessness with 3 points. Verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2, the day of the Lord. Verses 3 and 4 of chapter 2, doomed is the man of lawlessness. And verses 5 to 6 of chapter 2, don't you remember? Well, let's look at this first section, verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2, where Paul talks about the day of the Lord. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to Him. Paul starts out this new section with the phrase, now concerning, which reveals that he's now changed his topic from that of encouragement, and he's gone on to another topic, to the correcting the false teaching of the second coming of the Lord Jesus. And Paul deals with two issues at hand. First, the coming of the Lord Jesus, and two, our being gathered together with Him. And just by as a way of introduction, this verse teaches that the second coming of Jesus and the rapture or the resurrection of the believers are connected. Some people teach there's a rapture, and then years after that, then Jesus comes again. But in this passage, we're very much led to believe that when Jesus bodily returns, He will gather to Himself His people to be with Him and the Father and the Holy Spirit forever in heaven. So these two events are put side by side. First, the coming of the Lord Jesus. This is the second coming of the Lord Jesus. And of course, it's a major theme in the Thessalonian letters. This refers to the bodily return of the Lord Jesus upon the earth. Jesus came the first time bodily in human form, 100% human, 100% God. He died, was raised from the dead, ascended into heaven, and He returns to the earth the same way He ascended into heaven bodily. This bodily return means that when Jesus comes again, He will be visible to everyone on the earth, as Revelation reminds us. Revelation 1:7, "Behold, He is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see Him, even those who have pierced Him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of Him." Even so, amen. At this point, Jesus will judge the living and the dead. Jesus will separate the sheep from the goats, as we read in Matthew 24. And Jesus will gather His people with Him and punish those who reject Jesus Christ. At His second coming, Jesus' second coming, we who have trusted in Christ, who've received His grace, will see our salvation in the fullest sense. We will see fully that we've been rescued from the wrath to come. And we will also see the punishment of the wicked that Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians 1:8-10. This is what happens at His second coming. In flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His might, when He comes on that day to be glorified in His saints and to be marveled at among all who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. Next, our being gathered together with Him. But we will fully experience the hope and the joy of our salvation at Christ's second coming. Note that the being gathered to is a passive verb, thus revealing that God will gather us to himself with the Lord Jesus, and Jesus Christ will gather us. And this is a wonderful hope. We will escape finally the world of sin, all the hatred that we see. We will escape our own sinfulness and our own sinful body. This is a great hope for us because our bodies of sin will now be obsolete, and we'll have full joy in the presence of God our Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Paul had already mentioned this hope in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 5:11, and he called them to encourage one another with these truths. And now Paul encourages them with these truths. He says in 1 Thessalonians 4, 7, "And then we who are alive, who are left," this is speaking about the second coming of Christ, "will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." How wonderful will it be to be away from the world that beats us down, our sinful bodies that tempt us, and the flesh, the world, even Satan, and be truly free in the presence of the Lord. Our faith will be complete. Our faith will be vindicated. Praise the Lord. Well, Paul ends this verse with, "We ask you, brothers." Although Paul asks them, this asking is leading into a command. And do you note what Paul calls these Christians here? He calls them brothers. Brothers, which is in a term of endearment. He often does this in the Thessalonian letters. He's about to command something and he says, "Brothers." And what does Paul ask of them? Two things, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Paul asks them to do two things. First, do not be quickly shaken in your mind. This word shaken has the idea of being shaken by the wind or being tossed or being thrown off balance. I remember we were on a small lake and the wind really picked up and the waves were quite big and we were tossed back and forth. Paul here is calling these believers not to be taken off guard in their mind with regards to what people might say or what people might even attribute to him saying about the second coming of Jesus. Here we see that we're to be stable and strong and steadfast in our minds with what we have been taught in the Word of God. We're not to be tossed back and forth on essential truths of the faith, especially concerning the resurrection of Christ and the second coming of Christ. Number two, he calls them, don't be alarmed. This has this idea of being inwardly aroused or frightened. And this is exactly what Jesus says to his disciples in Matthew 24 as he speaks about his second coming. "And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See to that you are not alarmed, for this must take place. But the end is not yet." Paul is saying that they should not allow their emotions to control them, but be rooted in what Paul has already told them about the second coming of Jesus. And do you see what they're to guard against? A spirit, a spoken word, or a letter. The spirit here could refer to a revelation from the spirit that someone says that Paul got, or the spoken word refers to something that Paul might have preached or taught. And the letter, of course, referring to a letter that Paul would have written them. But Paul says something interesting here that seemingly to be from us. We see what's going on here, that people who were teaching this false doctrine of the second coming of the Lord Jesus were telling the church that this is what Paul was revealed to Paul. This is what Paul spoke, or this is what Paul wrote. These false teachers were spreading these false ideas, telling the church, this is what Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy were teaching. And this is likely why Paul, at the end of the letter, he doesn't do this often in his letters, the second last verse in 2 Thessalonians 3:17 says, I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. This is the sign of the genuineness in every letter of mine. It is the way I write. It is the way I write. We all know how this works in the real world, especially when we get on social media. How many people get their social media accounts get hacked, and then all of a sudden your friend whom you've known for years, they don't care about health, they don't care about your health, and then all of a sudden this person pops up on your social media account and they want to send you this miracle smoothie that's just going to make you feel like you were young again, or this miracle supplement, and you think, this can't be that person. Then all of a sudden the person says, sorry, I've been hacked, sorry, I'm not selling this or that. It's coming from them, but you know, or they're saying it's coming from them, but you know they've been hacked and it's sent from someone else, only mirroring or hiding themselves under your friend so they can sell you stuff and tell you something. These are the people that are saying it's coming from our friends, but they're hackers trying to get to us and sell us stuff. And that's what's going on in Thessalonica. People were faking what Paul had said and delivering this so-called message from Paul, and it was not true. Well, what were they teaching? That the day of the Lord had already come. These false teachers were teaching that the second coming of Jesus had already come. And imagine how devastating that would be if you are in persecution. Now, in light of what the Bible says about the second coming, certainly no one would ever teach that. But even this false idea is taught by a cult in Canada, the Jehovah's Witnesses. The Jehovah's Witnesses teach that Jesus came back to the earth in 1914. And so it even can happen in Canada, even in Dryden or the place where you live, that people teach this false teaching. So we have the day of the Lord. Now we'll go to doomed, this man of lawlessness. Verses 3 and 4. Paul writes in 2 verse 3, let no one deceive you in any way. We see a great concern for this church that Paul has. Paul doesn't want them deceived. We know that someone or some people were already trying to deceive the church and teaching that Jesus had already returned. And Paul's concern for this church is that they stay pure in their beliefs and practice. We see this concern for the church by Paul in several of his letters. Paul had concern for the Colossian church that they would not be carried away by bad philosophy and lose sight of the greatness of Christ. Colossians 2:8, see to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit according to human tradition, according to the elementary spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. He continues, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first. That day that Paul is referring to, the day of the Lord, is referring to the second coming of the Lord Jesus. So although the Lord does come like a thief in the night, like we read in 1 Thessalonians 5:2, and nobody knows the day or the hour, Matthew 24, verse 36, Jesus said that, we do know that the Lord will not come until there's a great rebellion, or some have interpreted this phrase to mean a great falling away. Paul is speaking about a time in history of the church where many who have professed Jesus Christ will no longer follow Christ. There'll be a time where interest across the globe for Jesus Christ will be at an ultimate low. And Jesus describes a similar situation of what will happen before he comes in Matthew. And because of lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. And what will happen after that? And the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. And now we get into this description of the Antichrist figure. This person is first described as a man of lawlessness because there will be great lawlessness in the land. A man of lawlessness rising up will certainly be a person of attraction. This means that this man will be a person who's against God's ways, God's laws. He'll be advocating for disobedience to God's ways or commands. And this man is going to be promoting disobedience in every area. Next, this man is described as a son of destruction. The word destruction here, when you trace that word in the New Testament, refers to the punishment of God, God's judgment. When you're destroyed, it means you've been punished by God in His holiness. Although this man rises up, he will be punished by God. Let's go to 2 verse 4. We see more descriptions of this man of lawlessness. He opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship. This man opposes God. He has no need for God. He even goes further. He exalts himself against God. You could see this person thinks that he's all that. He's kind of like a Mr. Perfect kind of attitude. He rejects God and he exalts himself to the point of God. And as for worshiping, he thinks, why worship God when I can adore myself? What does he do? Two more things. So that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. He takes his seat in the temple of God, and we're not quite sure which temple that Paul is referring to here. Some think it's the Old Testament temple rebuilt. Others think that the temple of God is referring to the people of God, like 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17, that he takes his place among the church or the people of God. Whatever the temple, we know this man of lawlessness sets himself up in a place of worship to be worshipped. And finally, he proclaims that he is God. As a human being, to claim to be God has to be one of the most foolish things a human can claim. But this man of lawlessness does it. Here we see this man of lawlessness, or this Antichrist figure, is against God's laws. He will be destroyed. He opposes God. He exalts himself against God and proclaims to be God. This man is guilty as charged in the area of idolatry. Idolatry of himself. And now we can go to our third point. We looked at the day of the Lord, the doomed man of lawlessness. Don't you remember, in verse 5 and 6, don't you remember when I was still with you, I told you these things, verse 5. This is our problem with our passage. We don't know all that Paul said to this church. If we did, all these questions that are very hard to answer would be answered. Leon Morris writes, this passage is the most obscure and difficult in the whole of Pauline writings. And many gaps in our knowledge have given rise to extravagant speculations. Although there's many blanks for us here, we do know they would not be blanks for the Thessalonian believers, because Paul had already talked to them about those things when he was with them in Acts 17. And the final verse, 2 verse 6. And you know what's restraining him now so that he may be revealed in his time? Although Paul does not exactly say what is restraining this man of lawlessness, we can confidently know that the man of lawlessness, like all people, this man of lawlessness is under the sovereign rule of a sovereign God. I think of Psalm 97, verse 1 and 2. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Leon Morris writes again. This is a wonderful quote about this section. What is abundantly clear is that God is over all. No wicked person, be he Satan, be the man of lawlessness, be he anyone else, whatever, can overstep the bounds of God as appointed for him. The man of lawlessness will be revealed only as and when God permits. He is not to be thought of as acting in complete independence. Throughout this whole passage, the thought of God's sovereignty is dominant, evil is strong, and will wax stronger in the last times, but God's hand is in the process. Evil will not pass beyond its limits, God's purpose, not that of Satan or his henchmen, will finally be effected. We can have confidence in God's sovereignty that the man of lawlessness will be revealed according to the plan and purpose of God. Well, how does this section apply to our hearts and lives? Just three things to consider now as we close. First, be rooted in the gospel and the word of God. And that's why Paul calls them not to be alarmed, not to be shaken in mind. Over the last years, I've heard many Christians label this person or that person the man of lawlessness or the Antichrist. And they've all been wrong, every single one of them. But Paul calls these believers back to his teaching that he first taught them. Paul taught them the gospel and sound doctrine. These are the truths that we must cling to at all time. The clear and concise truths of the gospel, like 1 Thessalonians 5, 9, and 10, that he taught them and wrote to them. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Or Acts 17, verse 3, Paul was explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, saying, "This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ." There we have the preaching of Jesus Christ, his death, paying the punishment for our sins, God raising him from the dead so we have the hope of eternal life. It is very easy in these times to get shaken in mind or alarmed, and that's why we need to press on the sure teachings of the gospel and the word of God. Because of Christ, we can be brought from death to life, darkness to light, and night to day. Christ Jesus can wipe out our sin record completely through the grace of God and through faith in Christ. That sin that we feel guilty about, through Christ, is forgotten and gone. Let us be a group of believers who are rooted in Christ in his death and resurrection. If you're frightened about end times, and this is the one topic that many non-believers want to talk to me about, if you're watching and you're frightened about end times, today is the day to know the Lord. Today is the day you ought to bow down and serve the Lord. Today is the day you ought to see that he did not destine his people for wrath, but Christ Jesus took the wrath of God in your place so you could have peace with God. And he was raised to new life so you could have hope. See his grace, see his mercy, see his death for your sake. Trust in his work so that you can have new life and confidence in the future with the Lord. Next, be reminded of this glorious hope of Christ. I said this months ago when we looked at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It's still true. If we ever needed encouragement in the church in Canada, it's now. People are beaten down. People are upset. Many schisms have happened in the body of Christ. In fact, I talked to a police officer this week, and he was shocked how people were acting and what people were actually verbally saying to him. Again, we're not immune to the stresses and the concerns that are brought upon the society, and we take them and we bear them too. But we have a glorious hope. We have the hope of being gathered together with Christ. We've all faced difficult times, but not nearly as difficult in the people in the book of Revelation. But we can have hope in the glory of the Lord. Hear this hope. And I heard a loud voice, Revelation 21, 3-4. Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for their former things have passed away. Life is certainly tough, challenging. Hope in Christ and see the beauty of his grace in this glorious hope. Our hope is not in any earthly thing or any earthly event or anything that might happen in the months to come, but our hope is being gathered together with the Lord Jesus for eternity, remind yourself and encourage yourself of this truth. And finally, be on your guard against false teachers. The only way you can guard against false teachers is being taught by God and by God the Holy Spirit through the Word of God. These Christians at Thessalonica were getting bombarded with persecution and false teachers, many fronts. People were trying to steal their hope in the Lord Jesus. Let that not be us. Let us stand our ground. Let us strive by the grace of God to keep in the Word of God day by day. Even if we think we don't have time, make the time. Let us strive to be in fellowship, because now it's been hard to be in fellowship, and many people have broken fellowship. No longer break fellowship. Strive to be in fellowship with faithful, God-fearing believers in Jesus Christ, even if you think you're strong in the Lord. A pastor friend of mine was speaking about how he was concerned about his congregation. And maybe they weren't as able to discern truth from error like he had hoped. Let us not be like that. There are many warnings about this and not being deceived in the Bible. Peter warns us, 2 Peter 3:17, "You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you're not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability." Jesus warns us, Matthew 7, verse 15, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." Let us be a people rooted first in the person and work of Christ and His grace, His mercy, and His Word by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.